Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. A couple of days ago, this channel reached 15,000 subscribers. I'm very happy to see the steadily rising subscription count. It shows that more and more people approve of this channel. Also, I really appreciate all your support. It gave me great motivation to improve myself in terms of organizing my thought, summarizing my knowledge, and to top it all, it also helps me make a lot of new friends. So, your support directly helps the channel's growth. I will definitely keep posting content on new topics and also elaborate on already introduced topics so that authentic and traditional practice will not disappear on my watch. It is my way of helping the present generation and passing the torch to future generations. Some community members may not fully understand my intentions, but I'm positive my content will stand the test of the time and the history of the internal styles will uphold my contributions. Thank you all once again for all your support. In one of my prior videos titled "Xing Yi Stepping: Conception and Imagery," I briefly introduced the imagery concept used in Xing Yi practice. I mentioned in that video that I will introduce more detailed information about this topic in the future. Let's replay that small clip first. So, many Xing Yi practitioners called it Six Art or Six Harmonies. But Sun Lu Tang called it Four Imageries by removing the ego capture and the thunder sound. Now, you may wonder which one is better. Well, Sun Lu Tang's version is easier to remember and memorize. However, if you are willing and able to remember two more imageries, then the older version is better. So it's totally up to you. But I have to remember both since I teach Xing Yi. In today's video, I will use the Sun Lu Tang's version since it is easier for you to remember. First, rooster stepping. This imagery emphasized the stability and flexibility of Xing Yi stepping. It is important to know that there are a lot of single leg stance in Xing Yi. Some of them are very obvious since one leg will be off of the ground. But there are many other stance which may look like two leg stance but are effectively single leg stance because only one leg supports the entire body while the other leg merely touches the ground. This kind of stance, which is very well described by the imagery of a rooster, makes the Xing Yi step very fast. Many years ago, a student of mine demonstrated his rooster stepping for me. He learned it from another teacher. I noticed that in his Pichuan step, when his back foot moves forward to the ankle of the supporting leg, he repeated his back foot moving forward and backward for 3 times. Then I asked him why he practiced like that. He said that his teacher told him that in Xing Yi stepping, one has to repeat the forward and backward movement by the hanging foot at least 3 times, since Xing Yi used the rooster stepping. Then I asked him why not 5 times. He said that 3 is a good number in Chinese tradition. I mentally face-palmed on hearing this. What a ridiculous story. Second, dragon body. To the best of my knowledge, dragons do not exist, neither in China nor elsewhere. However, that they may exist for you if you become too obsessed with the Game of Thrones. But regardless, the dragon is a very interesting imagery in Chinese culture, and many martial artists used dragon imagery to describe the body movement in practice, including upward motion and spiral body movement. So, the dragon body imagery in Xingyi requests to make the whole body flexible in order to release a comprehensive force. Remember, in the context of Xingyi, we should imitate the dragon imagery, and not just merely twist the body or imitate some person's imagination of a dragon's movement. Or it will end up being an imagery of an earthworm, which is definitely not Xingyi. Third, bare shoulder. We all know what the characteristics of bare shoulders are. They are strong, powerful, and flexible. Based on my personal experience, when I judge someone's Xingyi practice, very often I pay attention to their shoulders, because if they practice Xingyi correctly and diligently, their shoulder should be very strong. Fourth, tiger head or tiger holding its head. This is the controversial term in the Xingyi full imagery concept. Some people call it tiger head, while some others call it tiger holding its head. The first version emphasized that in Xingyi practice, one's neck should be as strong as tiger's neck. Here, head actually means neck. The other version says that the imagery is like a tiger standing up and holding its two front legs in front of its head. I would say both of them are correct, but today I'd like to elaborate on the concept of Sixiang in much more detail, including its background, important aspects in practice, and misperceptions. Sixiang is a popular term, and I will present it in detail in today's video. Topics covered in today's video include: first, origin and the meaning of Sixiang; second, Xingyi and Sixiang; third, the practice of Xingyi Sixiang; fourth, principles of Xingyi Sixiang; fifth, misperceptions of Sixiang; sixth, demonstration; and seventh, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1: origin and the meaning of Sixiang. The term Sixiang consists of two words. Si means four, and Xiang means symbol, image, and so on. Originally, Sixiang is a philosophical term used in ancient Chinese philosophy books. More specifically, Sixiang is a term used in Chinese metaphysics for explaining the origin and development of the universe and society. Metaphysics is one of the core contents of Chinese philosophy. Even though the term metaphysics did not exist in Chinese philosophy and was actually borrowed from Western philosophy, metaphysics has been used in explaining and analyzing Chinese philosophy for approximately the last century. But the concept of metaphysics has been a core area of Chinese philosophy for thousands of years. For example, Yi Jing, or the Book of Changes, written between 6th to 5th centuries BCE, has a great deal of discussion on Chinese metaphysics. Also, ancient Chinese philosophers used the term 形而上学, or what is above form is the way, to express the original concept of Chinese metaphysics. Many of you may have seen this pattern before. Right away, you can identify that these symbols are used to express Chinese metaphysics. And many of you may also have heard the expression Tai Xu, or the universe is from emptiness, or great void, some things. Sometimes people call it 无极 or non-polarization. 太极 or great polarization is generated from 无极。两仪 or two principles are generated from 太极。两仪 includes two aspects, one negative, dark, and feminine, or 阴仪, and one positive, bright, and masculine, or 阳仪. Before I go any further, let me make this clear. Negative, dark, or feminine are not to be interpreted here as bad qualities.They are only meant to be the opposite of positive, bright, and masculine. 阴仪and 阳仪 are commonly translated to 阴 principle and 阳 principle. The 阴 and 阳 energies interact with each other and become 四象 or four symbols. Great 阳, lesser 阴,Lesser Yang and Great Yin. From Yang Yi, the Great Yang is the Yang among the Yin. The Lesser Yin is the Yin among the Yang. From Yin Yi, the Lesser Yang is the Yang among the Yin. The Greater Yin is the Yin among the Yin. So, at this stage, Liang Yi or two principles give rise to 四象or four symbols. This process is called 两仪生四象 or 两仪 generates 四象. 四象 continues the interaction and the union of yin and yang energies continuously and becomes 八卦 or eight trigrams. Great yang gives rise to 乾 trigram and 兑 trigram.Lesser Yin gives rise to Li trigrams and Zhen trigrams. Lesser Yang gives rise to Xun trigrams and Kan trigram. Greater Yin gives rise to Gen trigrams and Kun trigram. This is the process of 四象生八卦, or four symbols generating eight trigrams. The eight trigrams.Generates all other myriad things. Now, I believe when you see this chart and see these symbols, then they make much more sense. Since 四象 is a philosophical term, naturally it has been widely used for explaining and indicating different subjects throughout Chinese history. For example, in ancient China,四象 was used for explaining the seasonal changes, different directions, different stars in the sky, and four elements, metal, wood, water, and fire in the five element concept. Also, in Chinese culture, 四象 represents four types of divine animals, the Azuri dragon, the white tiger, the vermilion bird,and the black turtle snake. All of these are some examples of the applications of 四象, a philosophical concept in various other fields. You can see how an intangible concept that originated in Chinese metaphysics has been applied to tangible objects, a very common phenomenon in Chinese culture. So, what about 形意?When and how did 四象 come to be used in 形意 practice? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 2, 形意 and 四象. The concept of 四象 was first introduced to 形意 practice by Sun Lu Tang in his 形意 book titled 形意全学 or 形意全 practice, published around 1915.In this book, he used the term 四象 to indicate four animal imagery in 形意 practice. In the book, he first introduced the 无极 posture, followed by 太极 posture, then 两仪 posture, the 四象 concept in that order. He chose rooster leg to represent 形意 stepping, dragon body to represent 形意 body method or 身法, bear shoulder to represent the 形意 back shape, and the tiger head to represent the 形意 neck strength. After 四象, he introduced the 三体 posture. So, in contrast to other 形意 documents, 孙禄堂mentioned 四象 before the 三体 posture. So, that was how 四象 was first applied to the 形意 practice. It is worth noting that 孙禄堂 introduced the 四象 in the 形意 beginning form. In other words, 孙 borrowed the 四象 from ancient Chinese metaphysics and applied it in the form of animal imagery in 形意 's preparation form. It was the later generations that applied 四象 as a general guiding principles in 形意 's practice. I would like to point out that 孙禄堂 also introduced the 四象 concept into 八卦 and 太极. Since this video will focus on 形意 practice, I will talk about 四象 in the context of 八卦 and 太极 in future videos. As already mentioned in the replayed video, 孙禄堂 used 四象 or four animal imageries to express the body shape and the animal spirit in the 三体 stance. Now, you may say that 孙禄堂 did not talk about 四象 in 三体 practice. Well, that is not true. Actually, 四象 is the starting point of 三体, and 三体 practice should carry on the 四象 concept and practice. In other words, a practitioner should be able to apply the 四象 concept in the 三体 stance practice. However, a concept created by the older generation can be developed further with time. 孙禄堂's 四象 concept has been adapted by many later generations of practitioners. Back when I was a child, the proverb鸡腿龙腰熊背虎抱头 or rooster stepping dragon body bear shoulder tiger neck had become very popular in the 形意 community, and it remains popular to this day. So, 四象 concept can be applied to 桩功 or stand training, 身法 or body method training, 身形 or body structure training,身势 or body movement training, and so on. Again, I'd like to point out that you cannot mechanically apply the 四象 concept to practice. A human being is different from an animal. In 形意 practice, you need to master the animal spirit, not the physical shape. Any mechanical imitation of animal movementswithout mastering the animal spirit behind the physical aspect is just wrong. Internal style practice requires a conceptualization process, a process that extracts the essence of an animal's movement and then internalizes and integrates it with practice. That's the only correct approach.Therefore, having a deep understanding of 四象 will greatly help a practitioner make progress in practice, and it should not be neglected. By the way, 江荣桥's book, 形意母权, or 形意 Five Elements on page 8, says, quote, 身成六式，鸡腿龙身，熊膀鹰爪，虎豹雷烟 end quote. Translation. Body has six postures. Rooster leg, dragon body, bear shoulder, eagle claw, tiger holding, and thunder sound. End translation. He used six harmonies and six postures to express these six practices, different from Sun Lu Tang's 四象 approach. So, how should you actually apply 四象 in your 行意 practice? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 3, the practice of 行意四象. In order to clearly explain 行意四象,I'd like to change the order of the individual aspects of 四象 a little. First, rooster stepping implies the 行意 stepping or leg practice. Second, bare shoulder implies the arm practice. Third, dragon body implies the upper body structure and movements, or 身法. And fourth, tiger neck implies the mental state in practice.Since in martial art practice, neck posture is directly related to the mental state expressed through facial expressions. Together, these four animal imageries form the 行意 spirit, which covers the entire body's physical and mental requirements. Now, I'd like to explain them one by one. First,Rooster steppings. It is very important that traditional 行意 practice always avoids distributing the weight evenly between both legs, aka a double weighted stance. So, most of the time, one leg is substantial while the other is insubstantial. In Chinese martial art practice,The rooster stance is always described using the term 金鸡独立 or golden rooster stance on one leg. In 行意 stepping practice, you almost always need to support a majority of your body weight on one leg and the entire body weight, in some cases, both of which are expressed using the term 金鸡独立or golden rooster stands on one leg. This is why in the traditional 行意 practice, you do not see a 50-50 body weight distribution when moving forward and backward. It is worth noting that 行意 stepping really focuses on the hips, since the hip is the root of the leg, according to the 行意 concept. Fast 行意 stepping is controlled by training the hips,which requires special attention in practice. So, you need to practice a one-legged stance, distribute your body weight correctly, and control the movement from the hip. Only then will you achieve rooster stepping. Second, bare shoulder. As mentioned earlier, a bare shoulder implies training the arm.In 行意 practice, most of the time, the shoulders should naturally sink downward while maintaining a slight space in the armpit area. This posture will provide two benefits. First, the entire body will possess a sinking motion. Second, the upper body and the arms will maintain an expanding motion, which is the foundation of a六面支撑, or energy expands to six directions. Very often, the bare shoulder also implies that the upper back should extend outward as well, which is the typical 行意 upper body structure. So, bare shoulder requires the upper body to be not only strong but also flexible. As a result,The upper part of the body becomes powerful and flexible in movement. So, you need to sink down your shoulders, strengthen your shoulders, and release energy through the shoulders. Only then will you achieve bare shoulder. Third, dragon body is directly related to 行意身法 or 行意 body method.In 行意 practice, the body normally has the natural twisting motion, especially in fa li action. So, adjusting the tension in the body between relaxed and tensed states will help the body generate an optimal level of energy in combat. Traditional 形意 practice emphasizes two words, 曲 and 停. 曲 means bending or curving, while 停 means extending or releasing. The natural state of 形意 is the balanced state between 曲 and 停. Therefore, anyone who misunderstands the differences between the 中和or neutral state and 曲 停 states will not be able to master the 形意 energy generation mechanism. So, you should try to generate martial energy from the 丹田 area, make the body dynamic and move the body fast. Only then will you achieve dragon body. First, tiger neck. This is an even more advanced topic. As I mentioned in the prior section, maintaining a correct neck posture will greatly strengthen the body structure. Also, it is closely related to the mental state in martial practice. The internal styles really emphasize the mental and psychological aspect, not only in combat, but also in daily form and routine practice. Furthermore, neck posture in martial practice can help maintain the stability of the body during martial movements. For example, if you feel that you lack physical balance during practice, focusing on the neck position will gradually help you improve it. So, you should push the top of the head upward naturally, maintain a strong neck position and look forward toward the opponent. Only then will you achieve tiger neck. The above topics are advanced. Easier said than done. It is impossible to master all four aspects at once, but consistent effort over time will definitely help you make it second nature. So, what are some important principles of 形意四象? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 4. Principles of 形意四象. Practice without principles will not take you too far. I'd like to introduce one important principle in today's video. It is 四象合一, or unity of 四象 as one. I created this term to highlight the importance of the approach of internalization of 四象. Yes, when you practice 四象, you start by focusing on each of them separately. However, in the end, all four aspects should be applied naturally and simultaneously. In other words, at an advanced level, these four aspects should become second nature and you shouldn't need to make any special effort in expressing these four aspects in practice. Internalization of 四象 should be an objective of practice. So, 四象合一 is a natural way to apply these four aspects into practice without forcing them. If you notice your practice to be lacking in 形意 characteristics, I recommend you work on the unity of 四象 and I'm sure your practice will improve with time. Also, bear in mind that 四象 is not limited to any specific martial techniques. 四象 is a general principle of 形意 practice. Analyze the 四象 concept by limiting the focus to its martial application is a totally wrong approach. As is in the case with other internal style concepts, 四象 is also rife with misperceptions which we will look at in the next topic. Topic 5, misperceptions of 形意 四象. Well, there are many misperceptions about 形意 四象. I will talk about two of the most common ones in today's video. Those are, first, dragon body is the same as dragon form. Second, bear shoulder and tiger neck are contradictory. First, dragon body is the same as dragon form. This is a very common mistake. Dragon body is the body structure and the power generation mechanism, while dragon form, no matter what branch of 形意, is the specific movement with compact applications. In other words, the form is the general concept and the mechanism, while the latter is the specific technique. Or in other words, the form is an imagery, while the latter is an expression of imagery through physical movements. They are totally different. It's just like the situation between a rose and its scent. The dragon form is the rose, while the dragon body is the scent. Second, bear shoulder and tiger neck are contradictory. This is another misunderstanding of the relationship between bear shoulder and tiger neck. The reason is that people perceive the bear shoulder as the posture in which the shoulder rises upward while the head sinks downward. Yes, sometimes the height of the head can be lower while the shoulders rise upward simultaneously. But even though the shoulders may rise upward sometimes, the lowering in height of the head is achieved by the sinking of the body, especially the sinking of the hips, and not by the sinking of the head by intentionally bending or softening the neck. Overall, in martial practice, the head usually maintains an upward motion and at a maximum, the changes to a natural state instead of upward motion. Regardless, you should try to avoid a sinking motion unless you need to evade an attack to the head. So, bare shoulder requires the shoulders to be relaxed and sink downward most of the time, while tiger neck requires the neck to normally maintain an upward motion or neutral state, which is the natural and intended coordination, not a contradiction. Those were two of the common misperceptions of 形意四象. I will introduce more in the future. Topic 6, demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate the 四象 practice in 三体 posture training. Again, for the purpose of clarity, I will exaggerate the movement, but in your actual practice, these have to be subtle movements in a natural state. Okay, when you practice 三体 stance, instead of just stand like this, then adjust the body according to 四象 principle. So, the shoulder extend outward, then slightly forward. Second, body has the twisting motion. Then third, shoulder sink downward, palm extend forward. Then the hip sink downward. Keep the lower back flat, and then raise up your spirit like this. Seven takeaways. First, 四象 was originally a term used in Chinese metaphysics. It has been adapted to describe many entities in different fields. Second, Sun Lu Tang was the first to use 四象 in the context of martial art practice. In his book, he used 四象 in the form of four animal imageries: rooster leg, dragon body, bear shoulder, and tiger neck. 3. Practice of 四项. First, you need to practice a one-legged stance. Distribute your body weight correctly. Control the movement by the hip. Only then will you achieve rooster stepping. Second, you need to sink down your shoulders, strengthen your shoulders, and release energy through the shoulders. Only then will you achieve the bare shoulders. Third, you should try to generate your martial energy from the Dantian area, make the body dynamic, and move the body fast. Only then will you achieve dragon body. Fourth, you should push the top of your head upward naturally, maintain a strong neck position, and look forward toward opponent. Only then will you achieve tiger neck. Fourth, the 四项 aspect of rooster stepping, dragon body, bear shoulder, and tiger neck have to be initially practiced separately, with gradual progress toward unified natural practice at an advanced level. Fifth, those are: first, dragon body is the same as dragon form. Second, bear shoulder and the tiger neck are contradictory. Please keep in mind that these are misunderstandings of the 四项 concept and should be avoided. Do not forget to check out the demonstration section to get a better understanding of 四项 in 3T standard training. That brings us to the end of today's video. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.